Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Today I'm going to discuss with you another diseases of the anal canal, anal fissure and anal incontinence. Firstly, anal fissure. Now, by definition, what is anal fissure? An anal fissure, which is synonymous with fissure and ano, is a longitudinal split in the anoderm of distal anal canal, and this extends from the anal verge proximally towards, but not beyond the dentate line. So it is split only in the anoderm up to the dentate line. Here you can see this is fissure and ano, and this is the anal opening area, and this is the anal split in the anal derm. So as far as talking about the epidemiology of the anal fissure, this is common in age group between 30 to 50 years of age. It is more common in males when we compare with the females. It is not rare in children, but may also occur in even infancy. When we compare with the young ones, adults, it is uncommon in elderly. The reason is of relative muscular atony in elderly patients. When we talk about the site or the location of the anal fissure in men, it is in majority of the cases is posterior midline. 99% So 99% cases is the posterior midline, only 1% interior midline. In women, on the other hand, posterior midline fissure, they are about 90% of the cases, and 10% they are located, the site is anterior midline. So this is the difference between men and women as far as the location of the anal fissure is concerned. Then in etiology and pathophysiology of fissure and ano, three factors, they are very important: constipation, pain, and sphincter spasm. These all three factors, basically they have a role increasing one to the other. For example, constipation leads to sphincter spasm, and the sphincter spasm, because of the fear of pain, it also leads to constipation. Similarly, constipation leads to mucosal injury, and this leads to pain. And then if there is pain, that there is a fear of defecation, and this increases constipation. Similarly, pain also increases sphincter spasm, and then there is a sphincter spasm, and increased sphincter spasm, so that also results in, and this also increases the pain. So this is how these three factors, they affect each other. Now, as far as the etiological agents, when we can say exact etiology, exact cause is unknown. But there are different hypotheses. One hypothesis is ischemic hypothesis. Now what happens here in ischemic hypothesis, constipation, digital evacuation of stool from the anal canal, sometimes even diarrhea, that leads to trauma to the local anoderm. And this, because this is area which is supplied by the somatic nerves, this leads to the pain here, in the anoderm leads to sphincter spasm. And this sphincter spasm then results in ischemia of that area, and which results in a breakdown of the anoderm, and ultimately can result in chronic ulcer. So this is how ischemia occurs and which leads to anal fissure. This is one hypothesis. Posterior midline fissures, they are more common. Why? Reason is because this area is subject to greater pressure by the fecal matter when that is passed during defecation. This area also has a low vascularity that renders it ischemic when fecal matter, hard stool, they are formed, they are passed. So this low vascularity, then ischemia results in breakdown of the anoderm and ulcer formation, which results in anal fissure. Now, what is the reason for anterior midline fissures, which is common in females? Cause is vaginal delivery that leads to damage to the pelvic floor. There is lack of support of anal mucosa anteriorly. So this is how anterior midline fissures, they occur, and they are more common in female. Usually we divide fissure in anal fissure into primary or secondary. Now, what is secondary anal fissure? So, and when we suspect this is a secondary anal fissure, when the location that is elsewhere around anal circumference are with atypical features in anal fissure, we can suspect that probably this is a secondary anal fissure. That means, so what is meant by secondary anal fissure? When there is some underlying disease and that disease results in the formation of anal fissures. For example, Crohn's disease, tuberculosis, sexually transmitted diseases, or HIV related ulcers. So syphilis, chlamydia, lymphogranulomatosis, they all can result in fissure and anal formation. Similarly, squamous cell carcinoma is one cause, underlying cause of anal fissure. So this is how we divide that fissure may be primary or it may be secondary. The other thing that we can sometimes classify the anal fissure in different ways. Now, there are different ways to classify a fissure in anal. One way in which I classified just now was whether the fissure is primary or it is secondary. Primary, obviously, when there is no underlying cause and it is basically the trauma by hard stool, sudden straining that results in the fissure formation. And what is secondary fissure? When there is some underlying disease in the form of carcinoma, tuberculosis, and inflammatory bowel diseases, and sexually transmitted diseases, they result in formation of fissure and anal secondary fissure. Then we can classify anal fissures according to the duration. Fissure can be acute, it can be chronic. When the symptoms they are less than of 6 weeks duration, we can say this is acute anal fissure. On the other hand, when the symptoms they prolong more than 6 weeks, or even if the symptoms they are less than 6 weeks, but on examination we find then there are features of chronicity. And what are those features of chronicity? If we see a sentinel pile, a anal tag at the lower end of the anal fissure, these are signs of chronicity, and we label this fissure as a chronic fissure. This is one way of classifying the fissure into acute or it's a chronic anal fissure. So now we come to the another way of classifying, which is based on morphology, that anal fissure can be a superficial variety, superficial for ulcer formation, or it can be a deep fissure or deep ulcer formation. What is superficial fissure? Superficial separation of anoderm with sharp edges. This is the picture in cases of superficial ulcer. In these cases, in the base of the fissure, we don't see any internal sphincter. This is important when we compare with the deep ulcer. Majority of the superficial ulcers, they heal spontaneously within days or weeks with conservative management. On the other hand, what is deep ulcer? Deep ulcer often with visible fibers of internal sphincter. So at the depth of the, at the base of the ulcer, we can see fibers of internal sphincter, which indicate that this is deep fissure. There is minimal granulation tissue formation in the base in cases of deep fissures. They are composed of indurated ulcer edges. There is distal skin tag, and there is also proximal anal hypertrophic papilla, which also demarcates that it's a deep ulcer, deep fissure. Deep fissure, they often persist and even either tend not to heal without intervention, or sometimes they recur. So these are the features of deep fissure, deep ulcer. This is another way to group anal fissures. Now, how the anal fissure presents? The symptomatology of the fissure and ano. The most important symptom of the anal fissure is pain during defecation. These patients, they have very severe pain. Painful defecation, the number one cause is anal fissure. There is severe anal pain during defecation and just after defecation. This resolves spontaneously after a variable time, only to recur at the next evacuation. Another feature of anal fissure is they sometimes present with bright red bleeding per rectum, per anum. There is, patient says that he passes fresh blood per rectum during defecation. Drops fall in the commode. Another clinical feature of symptom of anal fissure is perianal itching, and this is secondary to irritation from sentinel tag or sometimes discharge from the ulcer. Another important association of anal fissure is constipation. Patients with anal fissure, they are constipated. Reason, because it's a painful condition of the anus. And patient, during defecation, patient tries to avoid defecation, and this results in increasing constipation. So these were the clinical features of fissure and ano. Now, on physical examination in these patients, when we do physical examination, we can, fissure is diagnosed. It can be visualized by just gentle parting of the buttocks and then everting the anal verge, and you can see there is anal fissure as posterior. Then the other important part of examination is what is the position of the fissure, whether it's a posterior midline fissure or it's a anterior midline fissure. Then we also note features of acute or chronic fissure. I told you in the previous slide, the chronic fissure is the features are, you usually have a sentinel pile. There's a distal skin tag at the lower end, and even a hypertrophic papilla in the upper end of the fissure. Digital rectal examination, proctoscopy, and sigmoidoscopy. It is not routine. It should not be done in these patients when the patient is awake. Indication of these procedures is when we examine them under anesthesia, EUA, examination under anesthesia. So when we have patient is under anesthesia, we must do proctoscopy, even we can do sigmoidoscopy. And the objective is just to exclude any secondary cause of the fissure. So this is where digital examination, proctoscopy, and sigmoidoscopy should be done. Examination should be done under anesthesia. Without anesthesia, digital examination, proctoscopy, and sigmoidoscopy, they are contraindicated because they are very painful. Now, the treatment of anal fissure, when we talk about the treatment of the anal fissure, we can treat especially the acute anal fissure conservatively. And then we have a treat option of surgical treatment. Now, what is conservative treatment which is helpful in majority of the cases of acute anal fissure? What is the, now the main objective to treat is to treat the constipation, and this we do by adding fiber to the diet, encourage water intake, laxatives they are added to make the stool soft. So this is how associated constipation is treated. Then the role of local anesthetic agents. We use 5% xylocaine amoroidal ointment, lignocaine jelly. It is a local anesthetic and this gives relief to the pain. Then antibiotics are also used, fluoxacin, then metronidazole, flagyl, also used in especially to treat the anal fissures. Another part of the conservative management is sitz bath. Now what is sitz bath? It is basically a way of fomentation of the bottom of the anal verge. Patient sits in the tub having a warm water. It's not hot water, warm water. Sometimes we add antiseptics in this warm water and patient sits in that for 5 to 10 minutes, and this gives relief to the patient for the pain and also increases the, and it promotes healing. So this is one way of treating anal fissure conservatively, and these are usually helpful especially when we are doing for acute anal fissure. Then this is the only treatment this will be helpful. So another aspect of conservative management is application of locally that we apply some drugs that release the nitric oxide like glycerol trinitrate GTN 0.2%, then diltiazem 2%. These are available as ointment. GTN 0.2% is used four times a day at anal margin. The side effects of this GTN, they are headaches and even recurrence with this treatment. This is the side effect or the complication, you can say. Then diltiazem 2% ointment is again used. It is in twice a day and applied at the anal margin. It basically releases nitric oxide. Now the mechanism of action is it produces nitric oxide, which leads to relaxation of the internal sphincter, reduces the spasm, and this results in relief of pain and increases vascular perfusion in the area, leading to promotion of healing by using these agents. Another part of conservative management is botulinum toxin injection. The site of injection of this toxin is internal sphincter. Now, mechanism of action of this toxin, botulinum toxin, is it inhibits presynaptic release of acetylcholine from the cholinergic nerve endings. So that results in the paresis of striated muscle, and that releases the spasm of the sphincter and relief gives pain. Other uses of this toxin, it is used in achalasia cardia, sphincter of Oddi dysfunction, and Frey syndrome. These are, by the way, other uses of the this botulinum toxin. Now, if we go to the surgical options for the treatment of anal fissure, historically, under regional or general anesthesia, different treatment surgical options, they are available. One option is anal dilatation. Then another is sphincteroptomy in the base of the anal fissure. lateral anal sphincterotomy is another surgical option, and anal advancement flap. This is again another surgical procedure which is done for anal fissure, chronic anal fissure. Now, what is anal dilatation? It is also called Lord's procedure, Lord's anal dilatation. Lord's is a term which is also used for Lord's operation for hydroseal. But this is Lord's procedure. Keep in mind when we are talking about the anal dilatation. Patient in the lithotomy position, it is done under general anesthesia. So manually 4 to 8 finger dilatation, sphincter dilatation is done. Useful, this is useful in young men with very high sphincter tone. But it is also have risks, complication. And the important complication risk is incontinence, because it results in rupture of the sphincter fibers. So this is one way of treating anal fissure. The role is in acute fissures or also in chronic fissure. Another surgical option is that we divide the internal sphincter in the base of the fissure, which is posterior midline fissure, and internal fibers are usually visible in this. So posterior division of the exposed fiber of the internal sphincter is in the base of the fissure is one surgical option. It is also called sphincterotomy, posterior midline sphincterotomy. Indication is if the fissure is associated with the intersphincteric fistula. But nowadays we don't use this option. Disadvantage there that leads to prolonged healing. It can result in also fistula formation. There is passive anal leakage because of the resulting keyhole gutter deformity when we use this option. So these are the disadvantage of this posterior midline internal sphincterotomy. Lateral anal sphincterotomy is a wonderful procedure when it is indicated in the treatment of chronic anal fissure. It gives rapid relief to the patient. After this operation, patient says the pain has relieved. It's again done in lithotomy position under general and regional anesthesia. It has a open technique as well as a closed technique. This a lateral anal sphincterotomy, it can be done with both techniques. What we do, we palpate the distal anal sphincter, distal internal sphincter with the help of bivalve speculum at the intersphincteric groove. And this groove we can also palpate with our index and thumb. We give a small longitudinal incision the right and left lateral. Both sides, right and left, can be used. In the lateral position, you can see in lithotomy position, it will be on the right side, will be a 3 o'clock position, or it at 9 o'clock position. This where we give incision, small incision. We cut the mucosa, get the submucosal and the spheric plane, allow the exposure of internal sphincter fibers. We cut the internal sphincter up to the apex of the fissure. And then we can close the wound with absorbable suture. So what is lateral anal sphincterotomy? It is done at 3 o'clock position laterally. And what we do in this procedure, we cut the internal sphincter fiber, lower half of the internal sphincter fibers. This is lateral anal sphincterotomy for anal fissure. Gives rapid relief of pain in patients. Complication of lateral anal sphincterotomy, when we count, it is associated with hemorrhage. This can be reduced with the use of a local with a renin. Then it can result in hematoma formation. Lot of bleeding results in bruising of that area. Sometimes it results in a perianal abscess formation. Fistula formation can occur after this procedure. And it can also occur if the sphincter is damaged, incontinence. So these are the complications of lateral anal sphincter sphincterotomy. But if it is done safely, it's a wonderful procedure, gives rapid relief to the agony of the patient. Anal advancement flap, which is very useful in women and those with normal or low resting anal pressure. That means persistent, chronic, non-healing fissures. Edges are excised as well as the base of the fissure that is excised. Inverted house-shaped flap of perineal skin is mobilized to cover the fissure. Here you can see the flap is raised and it is advanced inside. After excision of the fissure, fissurectomy, that area is covered with a locally advancement of the flap of the perineal skin. Postoperatively, patients are advised stool softeners, bulking agents, and topical sphincter relaxants. So this is another technique to treat the anal fissure, chronic anal fissure, especially anal advancement flaps. So this was all about the anal fissure. Now the take home summary when we are talking about the anal fissure is that it can be acute or chronic, it can be ischemic ulcer in the midline of the anal canal. When the sites are ectopic sites suggest a more sinister cause, that means maybe some other diseases associated and that is resulting in secondary fissure MRI. In summary, the symptoms of the anal fissure, they are pain and defecation. This is the most painful condition of the anus during defecation. There may be bright red bleeding, mucus discharge, and these are associated with constipation. So this is all about the anal fissure. And now the second part of my lecture is we are going to talk about the anal incontinence. Now by definition, what is anal incontinence? Recurrent uncontrolled passage of fecal material in an individual. This is fecal incontinence. This includes fecal matter as well as flatus. So incontinence is both for feces or flatus. Continence is dependent upon the structural and functional integrity of both the neurological pathways supplying the sphincter and the gastrointestinal tract. So again I repeat, continence is dependent upon the structural and functional integrity of two things, neurological pathways and the gastrointestinal tract, that means the anal canal and lower part of the rectum. Now the risk factors for anal incontinence, they are many which are for the, there are different types of incontinence we can say. It may be a sensory type of incontinence, motor type of incontinence, urgency associated with incontinence, and soiling type of incontinence. These are the types. Sensory patient not aware of it that he is incontinent, reason is neuropathic, rectal or rectal prolapse. What is motor incontinence? Patient is aware of its incontinence but he cannot prevent the passage of fecal matter. Urgency results when there is radiation to this area, proctitis, there is inflammatory bowel diseases, they are associated with urgent type of incontinence and this results in poor reservoir, this radiation and this inflammatory bowel disease. Uncontrolled soiling occurs when there is anal scarring, then when there is a fecal impaction and patient passes mucus without any control. So these were the types of incontinence. Now, as far as talking about the etiological agents, etiology of the anal incontinence, general factors, they are: aging is associated with incontinence, dependence on nursing care, sometimes that is the cause of incontinence, marked obesity, this is maybe associated with incontinence, psychobehavioral factors, intellectual incapacity, this is another cause of incontinence, number of drugs, they may lead to incontinence. Now, number of causes we are talking about, they are under incontinence. So one way is the one we can say congenital or childhood incontinence, which is associated with anorectal anomalies, spina bifida, Hirschsprung disease, and then behavioral type of childhood incontinence. Then what is functional incontinence, which is associated with impaired rectal reservoirs, like in ulcerative colitis, in Crohn disease, in radiation proctitis. This is associated with functional type of incontinence. Reduced rectal reservoir for like low colorectal anastomosis or coloanal anastomosis, that results in incontinence. Diarrhea. This is also time when there is diarrhea, patient may be incontinent, and this is functional incontinence. Then maybe sphincter defects, organic sphincter defects. Maybe it is congenital. For example, example is imperforent anus. Then trauma can lead to sphincter defects like obstetric trauma, anal surgery like fistulectomy, hemorrhoidectomy, anal stretch, and sphincterotomy. These are the procedure with complication of incontinence. Now, diseases like fistula in ano, tumors of the rectum and anal canal, rectal prolapse, they also result in sphincter defects and incontinence of the anal, of the fecal matter, anal incontinence. Continuing with the etiology of the anal incontinence, then there are neurological factors. Pudendal neuropathy, diabetics, they may have incontinence due to neuropathy, degenerative type of neuropathy, then spinal cord injuries, they lead to a neurological incontinence. Number of pelvic surgery can lead to incontinence. Pelvic malignancy and irradiation. So, simple pelvic malignancy and then irradiation for this malignancy, that can also lead to incontinence. Parkinson's disease is another cause of fecal incontinence. Cause CVS, patient of CVS, they have fecal incontinence, and then maybe idiopathic type of incontinence. Now, when we assess these patients of fecal incontinence, what is required in history? We need detail of incontinence. What is the frequency? What is the nature, whether for solid, for liquid or gas? We have to distinguish between passive, urgent type of and post-operative type of incontinence. Then defecatory soiling we can inquire about, and what is the social impact of this incontinence on that particular patient. Associate symptoms may be that patient is passing blood, patient is passing mucus, and sometimes other discharge like pus may be there. We can assess this in a history. Also, we have to ask in history any previous anorectal trauma, any previous surgery, obstetric history, number of vaginal deliveries, prolonged second stage, and then about the episiotomy, tear use of forceps during delivery, and the tears during the delivery. comorbidities like diabetes, mellitus, again, we have to ask in the history. Comprehensive drug history is also important. Number of drugs can lead to incontinence, as I told you previously. So there are continence scores, number of continence score systems available. One is Cleveland Clinic scoring system, and the criteria in this scoring system is solids, liquids, flatus, use of pads, lifestyle alteration. These are the criteria which we use to score the incontinence, and the grades are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So these are the criteria and the scoring system, and one scoring system is obviously the Cleveland Clinic scoring system for incontinence. So this is how we score the incontinence. Now, on examination in these patients, when we examine these patients, obviously when we move for examination, we note underwears, we note pads, patient which is using, then generally what is the health of the patient, general physical examination. Then we examine the perineal area, we see any perineal deformity, any scars of trauma or surgery, we can see on examination of the perineal area. So we also see, we can see if there is any prolapse, any perineal descent, and this is also can be seen on examination. Digital rectal examination is done in this patient, and we assess the resting tone of the sphincter, and also ask the patient to squeeze, and we note the squeeze pressure when we ask the patient to squeeze the anal sphincter. So we ask, the part of examination also include perineal sensation. We have to check the perineal sensation in these patients when we are doing examination. So number of investigation can be helpful to assess the anal incontinence, like colonoscopy, manometry, endoluminal ultrasonography, and then MRI. These are the number of investigation used for the assessment of anal incontinence. Here is one endoanal, pictures of endoanal ultrasonography. This is the normal structure of the lower end of the anus with the sphincters, you can see. Here you can see this is anterior defect of the internal as well as external sphincter. This is external sphincter, here you can see internal sphincter, and there is the defect you can see on this photograph. Another gold standard the investigation for this area which we do is MRI. MRI is very useful investigation for this area. It is have a multi-planar capability, higher inherent contrast resolution than endoluminal ultrasonography. It is non-operator dependent. This not operator dependent. It is more expensive when we compare with the annual ultrasonography. So this is normal MRI, and here we can see interior defects of the internal and external sphincters. Here this is the defect. So this is external, and this is the external sphincter, and this is here, and you can see the ends. So this is MRI of this area. Manometry is another way to assess the incontinence, anal incontinence. So we can assess the resting pressure, which is more than 40 millimeter of mercury, the resting pressure of the sphincter. Then we also can also check the squeeze pressure when patient is exerting squeezing, and then it is more than 100 millimeter of mercury. We can also assess with this manometry functional anal canal length, which is usually between 4 to 5 centimeter. In female it is 3 to 4 centimeter. Then sphincter asymmetry can be assessed with manometry. Rectal balloons, they are used to check the sensation, to check the compliance to check the capacity of the anal canal and the rectum. So this is the use of manometry when we are investigating the anal incontinence. Anal manometry has a definite role to assess the anal incontinence. As far as the management is concerned, we have part of a conservative management. In these patients, after assessing, we can use agents to alter the stool consistency, like bulking agents, by we can use low bromide drug, so to reduce the incontinence in these patients. Similarly, treatment of cause, that is also part of the treatment, the medical treatment of anal incontinence, like cases of inflammatory bowel disease, irritable bowel syndrome. Then we also advise in these patients, depending upon the cause of the incontinence, sphincter exercises, especially cases of post-operative cases of in the operation done in this area. Then biofeedbacks, which results in 70% improvement in symptoms. Then there is enema program. Then topical use of phenylephrine. This is medical treatment of anal depending upon the cause of the incontinence. We have surgical options. Surgical options are also there to treat the anal incontinence. Then there are operations to reunite divided sphincter muscles. Then there are operations to reach the external sphincter and tuborectalis muscle sling. So number of operative procedures to repair the sphincter. This include number one, we can reunite the divided sphincter, and in cases of we use also to reach the external sphincter and puborectalis muscles, then there is flattening of the sphincter. Other options include injectable agents, sacral nerve stimulations, dynamic graceloplasty. Artificial sphincter are used. Stoma is also divertant. Stoma is also treatment in case of resistant cases of incontinence. This is anterior sphincteroplasty surgical option. Here we can see the divided sphincter that is repaired. There are two ways to repair the divided sphincter. External anal sphincter defects, they are repaired with this method. Overlapping technique as well as direct opposition of the ends of the cut sphincter. These are two techniques. Overlapping technique and direct opposition of the ends of the anal sphincter. This has good short-term results, 75 to 80% improvement at first follow-up. So immediate relief is up to 75 to 80%, but with time it is reduced to 50% or less after about 5 to 10 years. Other method to repair the sphincter, if the sphincter muscles are stretched and patulous, as they are often in old age and in cases of rectal prolapse, they may be tightened by post-anal repair by reefing the sphincter, which is through the use of darns of absorbable material to narrow down and plicate the external sphincter and the puborectalis muscle sling. This is another way to strengthen the sphincter. It is good, again, other method is injectable agents. internal anal sphincter pathology can be treated with this, and but we use the silicone biomaterial to inject into the internal anal sphincter. It is injected submucosally versus intersphincteric plane. Here you can see the technique where this injection of silicone is injected. Here this is the area where it is injected, silicone in the internal anal sphincter pathology. It approximately 50 to 70% gain. So injectable agents in the form of silicone, they are used, and usually this is done better under ultrasound control. Another way to treat anal incontinence depending upon the cause is sacral nerve stimulation. Sacral nerve, originally it was described for urological uses. Here you can see where this stimulation by using a needle is done. Sacral nerve stimulation. It is weak, but when it is used when the sphincter is weak but intact sphincter. It's not done for a cut sphincters. So it's done for weak but intact sphincters. Mechanism is poorly understood, but this is how we use this technique of sacral nerve stimulation using an electrode in the form of a needle. Good results, up to 90% they report improvement, and again this is done for weak but intact anal sphincter. So as I told you, one way is to support the anal sphincter. One method is dynamic graciloplasty, where gracilis muscle is used to augment when the sphincter cannot be repaired and it is damaged, it is cut and cannot be repaired. This technique of graciloplasty, where we use gracilis muscle to severe sphincter injuries, congenital malformation, here we use gracilis muscle. You can see gracilis muscle is mobilized and then it is rotated around the anal opening. This is the technique, the gracilis muscle, where it was mobilized and then it went around the sphincter through these subcutaneous tunnels. You can see the technique of graciloplasty, which is used where the sphincter cannot be the repaired cut sphincter, and gracilis muscle is used, sometimes even gluteus maximum that is used to augment the sphincter in cases of cut sphincter. Then also artificial bowel sphincters, they are available. Again, they are adapted from urological uses. Good results with successful implants. High complication rate because of they are foreign bodies. When they are put in the tissues, they have high complication, infection, erosion, pain, and obstructed defecation. Here you can see this is the artificial bowel sphincter. This is the artificial bowel sphincter. Here we can see how this is used around the anus. This is cuff around the anus. This is pump. And this is balloon reservoir. And we use this fluid by using pump from here when we require that there should be no fecal soiling and the cuff should be inflated around the anus. So artificial bowel sphincter is another option for the treatment of anal incontinence. And the last, when all the treatment fail and this incontinence is miserable, the only option then left is stoma formation. not without complication. Again, stoma has its own complication, but this is one way of treating. So diversion, colostomy, especially the sigmoid colostomy in the left iliac fossa, that is done to divert the fecal matter. We collect this in the bag. But again, this is not without complication. Number of complications, they occur with stoma formation, parastomal hernias, mucus leakage, diversion, colitis, and number of other complications associated with stoma formation. Stoma is one way of treating incontinence when this is not treated by other methods. So this was all about anal incontinence. Now, if you have any question, you can ask me in your WhatsApp group and I can answer your question there. So, thank you very much.